Please be seated. We are here today to remember and pay our respects to Burle Lee Robbins. He was born on May the 7th, 1928 in Dallas, Texas, to Jordan and Gussie Poor Robbins. He served his country and the U.S. Air Force during the Korean conflict. On May the 25th, 1962, he married Cosette Burgett in Dallas, Texas. Burle was a lifelong Dallas Cowboys fan and a master gardener in the Fort Bend County. He loved plants, hunting, and fishing. He and Cosette have lived in the Katy area since 2010. Burle passed away on Sunday, January the 14th, 2018, at his home in Katy at the age of 89 years. He is survived by his wife, Cosette Robbins of Katy, daughter, Robin Robbins, and her husband, Eric Monson of Katy, granddaughter, Jennifer Robbins, great-grandchildren, Dorian and Shauna, numerous nieces, nephews, and other relatives, as well as a host of friends. He was preceded in death by a son, James Bryan Robbins. The family is indeed grateful for your attendance today, and they ask that not only will you be with them on a day like today, but continue to be with them in the days to come. If you would, let's go to God in prayer at this time. Our Father in heaven, we come before you at this hour in a very special manner, remembering Burle, the life that he lived, and the impact that he had on so many. We thank you for the 89 years that he had here upon this earth. Though 89 to us sounds like a long time, we know that life is short and it was just a blink of eyes. And yet we're thankful for the time that we had with him. I pray that you will be with his family, that you will comfort them, be with his friends, and be with all who are gathered here today. And I know that if Burle could speak today, that the one thing he would certainly want us to know is that we need to live for you and love you, and help us to do that so that one day we may live with you. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we offer this prayer. Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught to say, it is well
With my
as we remember and honor the life of Burle this afternoon, it's times like these that we have mixed emotions. Obviously, the emotion of sadness because he's gone. But at the same time, there's emotions of happiness because he's no longer suffering. We know that Paul said that to depart is to be with the Lord in Philippians chapter 1 when he was discussing the possibility that he might be put to death, and he was torn as to if he desired to stay or to go on and be with the Lord. But he tells us that after death, it is to be with the Lord. And so with these mixed emotions that accompany a time like this, it's difficult to have the right words to say. And it would be a very difficult task for me to come up with those words on my own. However, thankfully, that is not the case. We have a God in heaven who has already spoken to us through his word to give us words of peace and comfort. Yes, the scriptures do tell us in Hebrews 9:27 that it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. Moses, the believed author of Psalm 90, in verse 10, talks about the years of our life, maybe 70, maybe even 80 years. In Burle's case, 89 years. But Moses goes on to say, but they soon pass away, and we fly away. James would tell us that life is short. It's like a vapor. It appears for a little while, and then it vanishes away. And so, what does God have to say to us in a time like this? I believe that in the first place, God would want us to know that he cares, that he loves us, and that he is there for us. Because in times like these, you need people to lean upon and to depend upon. And sometimes people here upon this earth, they do a good job at that. Sometimes they do not. However, God always does. He's with us each step of the way. He is called the God of all comfort in 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 and 4. Paul writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." And so he is the God of all comfort who is there to comfort us in our affliction. And I pray that the family will experience God's comfort, not just today, but in the days to come. We need to know that he knows what it's like to lose a loved one. Jesus here upon this earth lost a best friend. And you might remember when he stood at the grave of Lazarus. Though he knew that he was going to resurrect him, nonetheless, his emotions showed, his humanity showed, and we read what's known as the shortest verse in the English Bible. John 11:35, Jesus wept. And we can only imagine the emotions that God the Father must have experienced on the day that His Son was crucified upon the cross. And so there's times that people can come to us trying to comfort us, and sometimes they say, I know how it feels. And we wonder, do you really? But we don't have to wonder about that when it comes to God. He does. He knows what we're going through. He knows your pain, and he knows how to comfort you. The psalmist writes in Psalm 34:8, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. And so I believe that God would first want us to know that He loves us, that He cares for us, and that He will be there for us during times like these and during any situation that we may face. But I also believe that God would want us to know that Burl lives. Yes, his body today is in a casket, but his soul lives on. The Bible tells us that the soul is eternal. And Burl, being a believer in God, being a believer in Jesus, we read some words of comfort from God's holy word as a result of that. In Psalm 116:15, we read, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Now, precious. How is it precious? Because he's going home. He's going home. Revelation 14:13, and I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on, blessed indeed that they may rest from their labors. His battle with cancer, no more. Pain-free, no suffering, no tears. He's able to rest from his labors. So we already mentioned Paul in Philippians 1:23 with his being torn. He says, I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and to be with Christ, for that is far better. He now knows what that means. We dream of heaven, we talk of heaven, we think of heaven, but we can only imagine just how wonderful it will actually be. But he now knows. Jesus said to his apostles, as he was preparing for his death and his departure, in John 14:1-3, he told them, and he tells us as well, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That home that was prepared by Jesus, Burl now is there in the Father's mansion that has many rooms. And so, as we think of those mixed emotions, yes, his body but his soul lives on and remains. And because of this, we are able to grieve differently. Paul speaks to that in 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 through 18. And I want you to listen closely to these words as we think about days like today, but as we think about our lives in general and what really matters. Paul says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others who do not have hope." Do you hear those words? Do not have hope. Today, yes, you grieve, but you're able to grieve with hope. Why? "For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left unto the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words." Paul says, grieve, but grieve with hope. And why do we have that hope? It's because of the resurrection. Jesus died and overcame death. And because he did, then Burle as well will be resurrected. And there will be a reunion that will take place when the Lord comes back. We will see him again. And as Paul says, we will go be with the Lord, and there we will be always with the Lord. That's forever. That's eternity. And we look forward to that time that we may dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so now we ask the question, what now? As we move forward and continue to grieve the loss of Burle, what now? How should we proceed? Well, I believe that in the first place, I would encourage you to treasure the memories that you have of him and to be thankful of the impact that he's had upon your life. I'm sure we could go around the room and there'd be many stories that could be told about Burle and his life and his impact that he had upon others. But let him live on in your heart in that way, remembering him and honoring him. And then, in the second place, as we think about what now, we look to the things in Burle's life, though he wasn't perfect, because no individual is perfect. But we look to the things in Burle's life, the good and the impact that he did and that he had upon others, and we ourselves should strive to likewise have such an impact. Paul would say in 1 Corinthians 11:1, "Be imitators of me, even as I am of Christ." By no means is Paul saying do everything that I do, because he was a human being. But he's saying the good that I do, imitate that. And in doing that, you're imitating Christ. And so think about the legacy that he's left behind. And then I think most importantly, and what Burle would have to say to every one of us today, if he could speak to us. Because if you remember in Luke 16, verses 19 and following, there is a story about a rich man and Lazarus. And the rich man who lived his life in luxury here upon this earth, but did not live his life for God, he found himself in eternity in torment. And one of the things that he wanted was that he wanted someone to go back and to tell his brothers, to warn his brothers, to say, get your life right, because he did not want them to do what he had done. And so I know what Burle would say to us, because it's the same message anyone who has passed on to eternity would say to us. And that is, at the end of the day, it does not matter how much money you accumulate, how many degrees you might have, what kind of house you might have, what car you might drive. None of those things matter. The only thing that matters is that you live your life for God. That's it. John says in 3 John verse 4, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. And he would want that for every one of us, to live for God. Because if we will live our lives for God, then we one day will live with God for all eternity. And by so doing, not only are we with God, we are with those who have gone on to be with God, which would include Burle as well. And so, as we leave here, yes, we continue to grieve, we continue to have those mixed emotions, but let's honor his life, let's grieve with the hope of the resurrection, but let us make sure that we live our lives for God so that we can live with him for eternity. If you would, please join me in a word of prayer at this time. Our Father in heaven, we bow before you with hearts of mixed emotions at this time. But we are thankful that you have spoken to us through your word, and that through your word that you have promised that you love us, that you care for us, that you will comfort us and give us peace, and help us to draw near to you so that we may have that comfort and peace. Help us to realize what matters most, and that is living for you. Nothing else matters when we think about eternity. Father, I continue to ask you to be with the family and to bless them, and that they need your comfort and your peace and your strength in a very special way at this time. And as you have promised, you will give it to them. And so I pray that you will do what you have promised. We ask this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. This time we are going to be dismissed. We're going to have instructions on that, but there will be the graveside at the Magnolia Cemetery. All are invited to attend. If you would like to attend, there are instructions out in the foyer that gives us driving directions, because especially there's some construction taking place and you want to make sure that you go the right way. But I speak on behalf of the family and simply say thank you so much for being here and for your love and your support.
Fly away to that
Thank you.